Now we're going to cover a summary or highlights of the latest information in the 2020 American Heart Association Emergency Cardiovascular Care Guidelines that were published at the end of October of 2020. Now, even with all of the changes and improvements in the recent years, the American Heart states that less than 40% of adults receive layperson-initiated CPR, and actually fewer than 12% have an AED applied to them prior to EMS's arrival. There hasn't been a significant improvement in survival rates since 2012 for out-of-hospital cardiac arrests. While out-of-hospital survival rates remain about the same, the good news is in-hospital cardiac arrest outcomes have continued to improve. Now let's look at early initiation of CPR by lay rescuers. Laypersons should initiate CPR for presumed cardiac arrest because the risk of harm to the patient is low if the patient is not in cardiac arrest. Why do we make this statement? Well, new evidence shows that the risk of harm to a victim who receives chest compressions when they're not in cardiac arrest is quite low. Lay rescuers are usually not able to determine with accuracy whether a victim has a pulse, and the risk of withholding CPR from a pulseless victim exceeds the harm from unneeded chest compressions. Laypersons should receive training in how to respond to victims of opioid overdose, including the administration of naloxone. In regard to real-time audiovisual feedback, this was really unchanged and reaffirmed. It may be reasonable to use audiovisual feedback devices during CPR for real-time optimization of CPR performance. Now let's cover care and support during recovery, which is a vital and important piece to how to handle all of the things that encompass a rescuer, whether they're lay rescuer or professional, when it comes to providing CPR to a loved one or a patient. Debriefings and referral for follow-up for emotional support, whether they're a lay rescuer, EMS provider, or a hospital-based healthcare worker after a cardiac arrest event is definitely beneficial. Care and support during recovery included three new recommendations. One, cardiac arrest survivors should have a multimodal rehabilitation assessment and treatment for physical, neurological, cardiopulmonary, and cognitive impairments before discharge from the hospital. Secondly, cardiac arrest survivors and their caregivers should receive comprehensive multidisciplinary discharge planning to include medical and rehabilitative treatment recommendations and return to activity or work expectations. And thirdly, structured assessment should be given for anxiety, depression, post-traumatic stress, and fatigue for cardiac arrest survivors and their caregivers. Next, let's look at cardiac arrest in pregnancy. Because pregnant patients are more prone to hypoxia, oxygenation and airway management should be prioritized during resuscitation from cardiac arrest in pregnancy. Now, because of potential interference with maternal resuscitation, fetal monitoring should not be undertaken during cardiac arrest in pregnancy. Next, let's look at pediatric rescue breathing. For infants and children with a pulse, but absent or inadequate respiratory effort, it is reasonable to give one breath every 2 to 3 seconds, or about 20 to 30 breaths per minute. The rate was increased from the old standard of one breath every 3 to 5 seconds. Now let's look at pediatric opioid overdose. There were three updated recommendations under this topic alone. For patients in respiratory arrest, rescue breathing or bag mask ventilation should be maintained until spontaneous breathing returns, and standard pediatric BLS measures should continue if return of spontaneous breathing does not occur. Secondly, for a patient with suspected opioid overdose who has a definite pulse but no normal breathing or only gasping, like in respiratory arrest, in addition to providing standard pediatric BLS, it's also reasonable for responders to administer intramuscular or intranasal naloxone. Lastly, for patients known or suspected to be in cardiac arrest, in the absence of a proven benefit from the use of naloxone, standard resuscitative measures should take priority over naloxone administration, with a focus on high-quality CPR. Next, let's look at neonatal life support key changes. Newborn resuscitation requires anticipation and preparation by providers who train individually and as teams. Mostly, newborn infants do not require immediate cord clamping or resuscitation and can be evaluated and monitored during skin-to-skin contact with their mothers after birth. Prevention of hypothermia is an important focus for neonatal resuscitation. The importance of skin-to-skin care in healthy babies is reinforced as a means of promoting parental bonding, breastfeeding, and normal thermia. Inflation and ventilation of the lungs are the priority in newly born infants who need support after birth. A rise in heart rate is the most important indicator of effective ventilation and response of resuscitative interventions. Now let's discuss guideline recommendations in education. And this is extremely near and dear to our heart here at Pro Trainings, as we've really truly always believed that having more frequent trainings in smaller bite-sized pieces when it's most effective for you, in a location most effective for you, was vitally important. There was always too much distance between an initial in-classroom training and your two-year recertification. And it's refreshing to see that the science and the American Heart Association is now also backing this form of online and distance learning that's self-paced and delivered in small booster training sessions. Let's take a closer look at what these updates actually say. First, let's look at deliberate and mastery practice. The use of deliberate practice and mastery learning during life support training and incorporating repetition with feedback and minimum passing standards can improve skill acquisition. Booster training and spaced learning includes three recommendations. It's recommended to implement booster sessions when utilizing a masked learning approach for resuscitation training. It's reasonable to use a spaced learning approach in place of a masked learning approach for resuscitation training. Provided that individual students can attend all sessions, separating training into multiple sessions, in other words, spaced learning, is preferable to masked learning. So why was this recommendation made? Well, studies have shown that the addition of booster training sessions, which are brief, frequent sessions focused on repetition of prior content to resuscitation courses, improves the retention of CPR skills. Specifically for lay rescuers, the new American Heart Guidelines state the following. A combination of self-instruction and instructor-led teaching with hands-on training is recommended as an alternative to instructor-led courses for lay rescuers. If instructor-led training is not available, self-directed training is recommended for lay rescuers. Why was the recommendation made? Well, the American Heart Association guidelines state that studies have found that self-instruction or video-based instruction is as effective as instructor-led training for lay rescuer CPR training. A shift to more self-directed training may lead to a higher proportion of trained lay rescuers, thus increasing the chances that a trained lay rescuer will be available to provide that important CPR when it's needed most. The bottom line is that the latest scientific studies have proven that self-directed training works. The goal of lay rescuer CPR training is to increase the likelihood that people will act and provide CPR when it's needed. In addition, the new guidelines state that it is recommended to train middle school and high school age children in how to perform high quality CPR. By training school age children, it'll help to instill confidence and a positive attitude toward providing CPR from an early age. In situ training may be beneficial. In other words, resuscitation education in actual clinical spaces can be used to enhance learning outcomes and improve resuscitation performance. Virtual reality, which is the use of a computer interface to create an immersive environment and a gamified learning, which is play and competition with other students, can be incorporated into resuscitation training for laypersons and healthcare providers. Bystander CPR training should target specific socioeconomic, racial, and ethnic populations who have historically exhibited lower rates of bystander CPR. CPR training should address gender-related barriers to improve rates of bystander CPR performed on women. EMS systems should monitor how much exposure their providers receive in treating cardiac arrest victims. Variability in exposure among providers in a given EMS system may be supported by implementing targeted strategies of supplementary training and/or staffing adjustments. Healthcare providers should complete an adult ACLS course or its equivalent. It is reasonable for increased bystander willingness to perform CPR through CPR training, mass CPR training, CPR awareness initiatives, and promotion of hands-only CPR. I'd like to conclude the guideline update with a note on mobile phone technology. The use of mobile phone technology by emergency dispatch systems to alert willing bystanders to nearby events that may require CPR or AED use is now reasonable. The use of mobile phone technology has yet to be studied in North America, but the suggestion of benefits in other countries make this a high priority for future research.